Queridos amigos.
Dear friends.
Y con qué gusto lo digo.
And I say this with tremendous pleasure, dear friends.
Que cuantas cosas nobles,
all the
han sido
noble things
de la preocupación de la humanidad
that have concerned humanity have been mentioned here.
Durante un ya largo tiempo.
For some time now.
Los valores por los cuales ha combatido la humanidad.
The values for which humanity has fought and struggled throughout this century that is coming to an end have been expressed one way or another by you. The issues that have concerned us most with respect to this long struggle for independence, against colonialism, against neo-colonialism, against imperialism, the struggle of the peoples for equality, justice, development, sovereignty,
nunca tan amenazada como hoy.
Threatened today more than ever before.
La lucha por la justicia social.
The struggle for social justice.
La lucha contra la explotación, la lucha contra la
the
pobreza.
Struggle against exploitation.
La lucha
the struggle
contra
against
la ignorancia.
Poverty. The struggle against ignorance.
La lucha contra las enfermedades.
The struggle against diseases.
La lucha en favor de todos aquellos
the struggle in favor of all the dispossessed.
La lucha por la dignidad, por
the
la
struggle
igualdad.
For dignity, equality.
La lucha por el respeto
the struggle
a la mujer.
For respect
la lucha
toward women.
Todos los
the struggle for
de toda la
fraternity
clase.
Among men of all races.
La lucha por la paz.
The struggle for peace.
Todos esos valores y muchos
all of these values and many more
se han visto
have been
aquí.
Expressed here
a lo largo del encuentro.
During this meeting.
Por ello hemos, podríamos decir
and for that reason, we can say that it has not only been a meeting of solidarity with Cuba, and we feel proud for the fact that that solidarity served as inspiration. The blockade became the focal point of this meeting. Many have referred to the blockade. The comrades have referred to the blockade. Little could be added to that. But what is the blockade in essence? The blockade is not only the banning of holding any type of trade with our country on the part of the U.S., be it technology, machinery, foodstuffs, for instance, medicines. The blockade means that not even an aspirin can be sold to Cuba to mitigate a headache.
Oh,
or
un anticancerígeno.
an anti-cancer drug
que pueda salvar una vida,
that may save a life,
o que pueda aliviar el sufrimiento,
or that may mitigate the suffering of those who are in a terminal stage.
Nada.
Nothing, absolutely nothing can be sold to Cuba. The blockade is not only prohibiting all sorts of credits, financial facilities. The blockade is not only a total closure on the part of the United States of trade, commercial, financial activities by the United States, the richest, most powerful nation of the world in economic and military terms. At 90 miles away from our coasts, rather at 1 inch of our coasts in the occupied territory of the Guantanamo Naval Base. But that is not the only thing. That is not what the blockade is. The blockade is also an economic war against Cuba. An economic war. It is the tenacious harassment, the constant harassment around the entire economic activities of Cuba anywhere in the world. The United States actively works through its diplomatic channels, its embassies, to exert pressure on any country that wishes to trade with Cuba, to exert pressure on any firm that wishes to trade or invest in Cuba, to exert pressure and punish any ship that transports goods to Cuba. It is a universal war with that immense power to their favor against the economy of our country, to the extent of doing individual arrangements, even with people, with individuals who try to carry out some sort of economic activity with our country. They euphemistically call it embargo. We call it blockade. And it is neither an embargo or a blockade. It is a war. A war that now is not being waged against any country in the world, but exclusively against Cuba. But during these years of revolution, we have not only had to bear with the blockade, we have had to bear the unceasing hostility in the political field, from attempts to assassinate leaders of the revolution, going through all forms of subversion, destabilization, and even direct, constant sabotage against our economy. We, in these 35 years have been the victims of sabotage of all sorts. I will not only speak of pirate attacks, mercenary invasions, dirty wars in the mountains, in the plains, constant destabilization attempts in all fields, but rather we have been the object of direct sabotage with explosives, incendiary means. Our country has even been victim of chemical warfare with the introduction of toxic elements, of biological warfare with the introduction of diseases in our plants, in our animals, and among human beings. There is no weapon, no means that they have not used against our country and against our revolution on the part of the authorities and the government of the United States. The war against the Cuban Revolution has been total, absolute, and it is not an old war. That war is maintained, and at present they are drawing up, they are preparing plans to sabotage our economy, our strategic industries. At present, organizations quite related to the government of the United States are carrying out activities around the preparation of assassination attempts against the leaders of the revolution itself. Do not believe that these are things of the past. This is something of the present, and dirty war plans and plans for the infiltration of armed mercenaries to assassinate, to do sabotage, to create uncertainty, and to bring death to all corners of our country. I say this, and I say this very responsibly. These are plans of imperialism of this very moment against us. That is something more. Something much more than the economic blockade. And all this policy is accompanied by a constant campaign of slanders and lies against our country to justify their crimes. And now their main emphasis is in the banner of human rights. Human rights in the mouth of those who have committed and are committed terrible actions against our country. As we were recently telling the High Commissioner of the UN on Human Rights, with whom we talked at length, the most brutal and most cruel violations of the human rights of our people is committed with the attempt to make our people yield out of hunger and diseases, a people made up of 11 million Cubans. The United States, speaking of human rights, when they began by exterminating the first inhabitants of that country, they expanded the state at the expense of the territory of others, and they expanded by taking land from them. And that way, one way or another, they took away from their neighbors millions of square kilometers of land. Only in the case of Mexico, they took more than half of Mexico's territory. In the case of Puerto Rico, they still have it occupied. In the case of Cuba, they wanted to devour Cuba more than 100 years ago. In countries of Latin America, they intervened tens of times. In Panama, they imposed the canal on them. Just to mention our hemisphere, I'm not referring here to the Vietnam War or the war in Laos or Cambodia or these other places. It is not necessary to go too far into the past. In contemporary times, since the revolution has existed, what has been the history of the foreign policy of the U.S.? The champion of liberty, the champion of human rights. The closest alliance with the most repressive, bloody regimes that have ever existed throughout the world. If we think in terms of Europe, we recall that immediately after the World War, there was the alliance of the United States with Spanish fascism. Which was inaugurated with the weapons of Hitler and Mussolini. And that cost millions of lives until the end. We cannot but mention their alliance with the regime of South Vietnam and their genocidal war against the Vietnamese people in the south and in the North.
No podemos pasar por alto la guerra de Corea.
We cannot but mention the Korean War.
País que fue totalmente
a country
arrasado,
that was totally leveled down,
convertido en polvo,
transformed into dust.
No podemos
we cannot
Hiroshima y
ignore Hiroshima or Nagasaki.
Con el empleo innecesario de
with the
armas
unnecessary
nucleares,
use of nuclear
empleo
weapons,
absolutamente innecesario,
totally unnecessarily,
y que en todo caso podría
and
haber
that in any case could have been used against
militar,
some military facility,
y que cayeron sobre
which fell on civilian populations, millions of inhabitants,
la era del terror atómico,
to establish the era of atomic terror
en el mundo,
throughout the world.
No podemos olvidar
we
la
cannot
alianza
forget
con Sudáfrica y
their
el
alliance
apartheid
with South Africa and apartheid.
No podemos olvidar incluso que
we can't
apartheid
even forget that apartheid manufactured nuclear weapons. And when we were fighting in South Angola against the apartheid army, together with the Angolans, South Africa already had nuclear weapons, several nuclear weapons, and the United States knew that South Africa had these nuclear weapons and that these nuclear weapons could be used against human soldiers, Cuban and Angolan soldiers. But it was South Africa, it was racism and fascism. They that have created a tremendous scandal and have even threatened with war because of a supposed idea that the North Koreans wanted to develop nuclear weapons, and they allowed and they consented, and through indirect means they facilitated the building of nuclear weapons on the part of South Africa. But if we come closer here to our continent in more recent times, who can forget Nicaragua's dirty war? Organized through armed mercenaries that meant the death of tens of thousands of Nicaraguans and the mutilation of thousands of Nicaraguans. Who can forget that? The champion of liberty, the champion of human rights. Who can forget the dirty war in El Salvador, the support of the US government for a genocidal government, to which they delivered tens of millions in sophisticated weapons to crush the rebellion of the people? A war that meant more than 50,000 deaths. And why did the Malvinas War take place, or Falkland Islands? Simply because the United States used Battalion 401 of Special Forces in Argentina for their dirty war against Nicaragua and their dirty war in El Salvador. And they rendered such brilliant and pleasant service to the United States that they thought. It was time to occupy Malvinas. Who can forget
en Guatemala,
what happened in Guatemala
desde la época del gobierno de Arbenz,
since the period of Arbenz
en los años 50.
In the 50s?
Donde un gobierno popular elegido
where a government of the people, elected by the people,
intenta hacer una reforma
attempted
agraria,
to have an agrarian reform
ayudar a los campesinos
to help
y a la comunidad
the
indígena.
Peasants and the native communities. So then, immediately, a dirty war, the invasion of mercenaries, and then what? And what has happened up to today? More than 100,000 missing. A country where, during tens of years, the category of political prisoner simply did not exist, because they were all simply missing. Up to today. Who offered supplies to that government? Who trained that government? The champion of liberty. The champion of human rights. And what happened in Chile with Salvador Allende's people's government?
Contra él conspiraron. Su economía fue de diversos, de diversas formas.
They conspired against him. His economy was under blockade in many different forms, and conditions started to be created for the coup.
Trajo al país miles y miles de desaparecidos.
Which meant thousands and thousands of missing people and people murdered. And what happened in Argentina with that military government we were mentioning? And what happened in Brazil? And who supported the putschists and those who tortured, murdered, and disappeared people? Who intervened in the Dominican Republic at the time of the Camaño rebellion?
¿Quién invadió Granada?
Who invaded Granada?
¿Quién invadió Panamá?
Who invaded Panama?
Los campeones de la libertad.
The champions of liberty
y de los derechos humanos.
And of human rights.
¿Cuál de esos países fue hostigado?
Which of these countries was harassed? Which of these governments was harassed? Which of these governments was blockaded? Of all those I've mentioned, did they deny credits to any of them? Or trade? Did they stop selling weapons, war supplies? Who did they not train in the so-called anti-subversive actions? Who did they not train in the art of crime, the missing, and the tortured?
Y esos son
and these
los que bloquean a Cuba.
Are the ones that are now are blockading Cuba, slandering Cuba, accusing Cuba of violations of human rights
para justificar sus
to justify their crimes
contra nuestro pueblo.
Against our people.
Y es Cuba.
And it is
lo digo sin
Cuba, and I say this
lo digo sin
with a cold mind, I say this
índole.
Without any subjectivity.
El país que más
Cuba is the country that has done most for the human being. What revolution has been more noble?
¿Qué revolución fue más
what
generosa?
Revolution was more generous?
¿Qué revolución respetó
what revolution respected man most?
Y no ya como revolución
and not as a victorious
poder,
revolution in power,
sino de nuestra
but
propia guerra,
since our very war,
de nuestra propia lucha revolucionaria,
our very revolutionary struggle, which in which we established principles that could not be violated, because what made us revolutionaries was to repel injustice, crime, tortures, and our war, which lasted 25 months, and it was very intense, where we captured thousands of prisoners. There was not one single case of physical violence against people to obtain information, not even in the middle of the war. There was not one single case of assassinating a prisoner. What we did with the prisoners was to let them go free. Naturally, we would take the weapons from them because we were interested in the weapons. And we treated them with all considerations that these weapon suppliers deserved. At the beginning, they had made them believe that we would kill them all. And some even resisted to the very end. But once they found out throughout the war what was the behavior of the rebel army, then it was easier for them to turn over their weapons. And in some cases, some of those soldiers turned themselves over three times because they would change them from transfer him from one front to another front to another front. They would send him from one place to another. And they already had the experience. But the most important thing is that these principles of never resorting to torture, of never resorting to crime, these principles have been maintained without a single exception by the Cuban Revolution until today.
Digan lo que digan.
whatever they say,
escriban
whatever
escriban.
They write,
ya sabemos que muchos de
we already know that many of them, many of these writings were written by people paid by the CIA.
In the history of the revolution, there isn't a single case of missing person or torture or political assassination. A single case of a missing person. In Cuba, there are no death squads that proliferate like mushrooms in many countries of this hemisphere. In our country, we do not have these phenomenons that can be observed in other countries of children assassinated in the streets. In order to avoid the for them to beg for in the streets. The revolution did away with the need of begging. The revolution did away with gambling. The revolution did away with drugs. The revolution liquidated prostitution. Yes, there might be, unfortunately, there might be still some cases, certain trends, which as a result of the economic difficulties and as a result of the country's opening to contacts from abroad, they give rise to prostitution, and there might be some hookers. We do not deny this. On Fifth Avenue, you may see them, but you cannot confuse them with decent persons. There are cases, however, we struggle against these phenomena. We do not tolerate prostitution. It is not legalized. You don't see men homeless sleeping in the streets and covered with the newspapers in spite of our poverty, in spite of our current poverty. There isn't a single homeless in our country without social security. In spite of our current poverty. The vices that exist in capitalist society do not exist in Cuba. In our country, this is the work of the revolution. There isn't a single child without a school and without teachers. There isn't a single citizen who is not entitled to health services before they are born, because we began to care for our citizens before they are born, while they are still inside their mothers. Since the very weeks of their conception, we are a country in the world, or country in the world with the most doctors per capita. in spite of the special, in spite of the special country, period, and I say not of Latin America, but I say of the world, beyond the Nordic countries and the Canadians, countries who occupy the prominent positions of health care services the world over. We are the country with the most number of professors and teachers per capita. In spite of all the difficult situation, we are the country in the world with the most cultural instructors per capita and sports and physical education professors in the world. And that is a country that they blockade. And that is the country that they want to surrender as a result of hunger and disease.
La constitución la hemos hecho
constitution,
nosotros.
We drafted the constitution.
El código electoral
and
lo hemos
the
hecho
electoral,
nosotros.
We also
ideado,
drafted the
nosotros,
electoral code.
Está,
and this is what we have defended. In other words, the right of the country to establish the norms, the economic, political, social regime that they consider pertinent. Any other thing would be absurd, would be madness. And these madmen intend that for everyone else to do exactly what they do, and we do not like their system. They just elected a new Congress, where there is a trend towards a conservative position and towards an ultra-rightist position. However, these are the domestic problems of the United States. I assure you, I swear, that we have not told that the posed as a condition for the United States in order to normalize relations that they should renounce to that system. Can you imagine if we told them that at least 80% of the population had to vote? 38% decided at the election, and that was it. And the others said, well, I'm going to the beach. Or maybe I'll go to the movies. Or maybe I'll stay home and rest. That happens among the champions of liberty and the champions of human rights and civil rights. And in many countries of Latin America, the same occurs. Many people do not go to the elections because the slaves and the serfs say, well, why should I vote if things will never change? However, at our elections, more than 95% of the population turns out, and no one is forced to vote. Not even those who are in favor of the revolution or against the revolution. They vote. They cast their ballot, a blank ballot. But I repeat, the neighbors are the ones who make the nominations. The people makes the nominations, and the peoples are the ones who elect their candidates. So that's why I say that the possibilities for an ordinary citizen to be elected are infinitely greater than in other countries. Alarcón was explaining these issues when he recalled in a magazine that he was carrying, and he has the advantage that he speaks English and he's able to read American magazines. And he explained how a man had spent $25 million in his electoral campaign. What kind of democracy is that? How many people have $25 million to spend on a electoral campaign? And in Cuba, they do not even need to spend $25, perhaps the bus ticket to go to vote on election day. What kind of democracy is that where you have to be a millionaire in order to be able to have the necessary resources to talk to the people and persuade them to elect them, and then they forget about him until the next election? They'll never see him again. In Cuba, the positions are renewed. And the delegate to a district can be elected, but he can also be revoked from his position. That is our system. We do not intend for the others to implement this system, but this is the system that we have adopted. No one came here to force it on us. No U.S. governor came here to establish a code here in Cuba as they used to do before. At the victory of the revolution, there was a bipolar world. The United States imposed the blockade at the practically at the very beginning, and they began to eliminate the sugar quota. They also suspended the oil supply. Can you imagine a new revolution under those conditions? Of course, they also suspended the supply of spare parts and machinery, etc. However, the Soviet Union and the socialist countries existed. It was fortunate for Cuba, because in the face of the U.S. Blockade and the presence of the United States only 90 miles away from our country, there was another force, another movement in the world with a revolutionary essence, an origin, which was in contradiction with U.S. imperialism. And thanks to this, we were able to find a market for our sugar. We were able to find oil supply, foodstuff. As was explained here, it occurred that the socialist countries and the Soviet Union collapsed, and the blockade worsened. With the existence of the Soviet Union and the socialist countries, we felt better. We were able to resist better, and our economy resisted through 30 years and was able to reach an extraordinary social development. However, at the time of the birth of the Cuban Revolution, there was no other alternative in a country under a blockade by the most powerful country in the world. That is why the elimination or the disappearance of the socialist countries and the Soviet Union represented a terrible blow for Cuba, because the blockade was not only maintained, but it was enhanced. So our country lost 70% of its imports. And I ask myself if any other country in the world could have resisted. such a blow. And I also ask myself, how long could they have resisted? How many days? A week? 15 days? A month? How could they have resisted if it were not with the support of the people? And the support of the people? How could we have resisted, truly resisted, if it were it not that our democratic system, without the direct participation of the people in the fundamental issues, which is, in essence, true democracy?
Any other Latin American country could have resisted the brutal drop of 70% of its inputs? Could any other European country been able to bear or pass such a test? Politicians would have yielded even one day before. They would have capitulated. But we have dignity. We have a sense of honor. And we are dear to principles. For us, principles are more worth than life itself. And we have never, never negotiated one single principle. Look, when we were helping the Central American revolutionaries, the North Americans said that they would lift the blockade if we stopped assisting the Central American revolutionaries. We never even thought of such a thing. At times they said that they were ready to lift the blockade if we stopped assisting Angola and other African countries. And that possibility of negotiating our relations with for this had never came to our mind. At times they also said that they would lift the blockade if we severed our bonds with the Soviet Union. And we never dreamed of such a thing, because we are not a party or political leadership that negotiates principles, and at that price. The blockade would be eternal, because it is a price that we are simply not willing to pay. How many hundreds of thousands of children have we educated with our teachers abroad? We have not only sent professors of elementary school or junior high schools and even university professors, we have established medical schools in many countries of the world. Is it fair to blockade a country that does that? A country that has done that and is still doing it to a certain extent? More than 15,000 Cuban doctors have offered their services free of charge in tens of countries during the revolution. More than 15,000 doctors have participated in internationalist missions as doctors. More than 26,000 teachers and professors. I ask myself, has any other country, or even intermediate, maybe large country, has had this record. Suffice it to say that at a given moment we had three times more doctors working free of charge abroad in the third world than the World Health Organization. At a given moment, we had here 25,000 foreign students in scholarships in Cuba. It was the country of the world with the highest per capita in foreign students in scholarships. And we were not advertising that. We were simply doing our duty, simply, as Martí taught us. We are making changes, but without renouncing independence or sovereignty. We make changes, but without renouncing the true principle of the government, of the people, for the people and by the people. Which, translated to revolutionary terminology, is the government of the workers, for the workers and by the workers.